So in this semester, I will be teaching you computational biology and bioinformatics. So essentially, let me go through the syllabus once. First, let me share my screen. So this is the part which you have in your syllabus, computational biology. The first part is the basic components of a computer, where you have to study about all these systems: CPU, the input units, to output units, storage devices, and microprocessors. Then you have to talk about communication ports, which we will cover in the next day. Then we have to talk about operating system. We will be discussing two operating system. One is Windows and the other is Linux. One is Windows and the other is Linux. Then we have in the Linux commands, you have to study about command types, graphical user interface applications on Linux. You have to basics of Linux you have to study. And for this you need a Linux computer system. Even if you have a Windows computer system, you can use VirtualBox and sort of practice your Linux commands in it. Like I will show you how I use it. I will give a practical demonstration on that day when we go, that how we on your computer system, how you can actually work with Linux. So this is something which you really need to do. You need to acquire a computer. This is absolutely essential in modern society. Since if you have to give this paper, then you have the concepts of programming. So in this concepts of programming, although in the syllabus it's given about C programming, I think from a biologist's perspective, C is not that useful. Python is more useful. So we will discuss a bit about C and a bit about Python. So both these programmings, we will be talking about these two types of programmings. And then of course the data structures, the Comma, RDMBS platforms, the SQL in Python, you have to study about that. Then you have to start a bit about short note on Oracle. There we will becomes too much if you start to understand it. Becomes almost like a computer science course if you start now studying Java and Oracle and all these things. Although eventually you need to learn about all these things, it's better we will just cover Oracle very briefly. And we will talk about data structure and from the perspective of C programming and Python programming. And then computer networking and internet, this is something which we have to study. And then we come to the biological part of bioinformatics. What are biological databases? We will be talking about certain biological databases. Then some of the nucleic acid and protein databases, especially PubMed and Ensemble. And then we could also, there are several Cytoscape and all the several other where you can get lots of meta info on these databases, on how you can work. Because this is one chapter. So in for example, in currently in KNE, if you want to do your PhD, they are working on bioinformatics. So lot of students, a lot of your seniors like Ritik, now I guess Shomodi, Shampurna, you people know them. They are all basically working in Suprabhat Mukherjee's lab, and he works on bioinformatics. So you will be actually needing all these things if you really need to do PhD in KNU. Rather than wet science, you have to really go to in silico science studies. So this is something which you need. Therefore, I would go into details about these things. Then you have to talk about, understand what is sequence alignment, what are protein predictions, and what are pattern search tools. You can all do this in Python. So we will do this in Python as well as we will do this in normal Windows in the graphical user interface. And molecular modeling and docking, we will study briefly about it. Otherwise, this becomes too much for you. Because in this paper, you also have a part which is on biostatistics. this is also a huge part Pankaj sir will do. So this is going to be your toughest chapter. But nothing to worry, because I think this is the most scoring chapter also. If you know the concept, you get full marks over here. And I hope the papers should be easy in this part. It should not be too difficult. And with this, so let me go to my topic today. Which is the basic components of a computer system. You all of you are quite aware of this basic components of a computer system, and you know that you have got an input unit which connects to a central computer or the central processing unit, and that has got a region which is a processor or central processing unit, and it has got another region known as the memory unit, the RAM and the ROM you have, and you also have the processor chip which is attached to the microprocessor, which is a very arithmetic and logical functions are done, and you have the output your devices which are the which can be your monitor on which you are seeing, and your keyboard. It's of course even your Android phone is also a computer. It has got an input unit where you type on the screen what you want to do. You're talking, there is a voice receiver also for commands, and you have a central processing unit, you have a RAM over there, you have a internal memory over there, and the display screen is also the output unit. This is a wonderful device in which the input and the output unit are you can see them on one place. This is the other feature of the touch phone. Then we will let us talk about what an input unit is. Input is any data or instruction which is entered into the memory of a computer. So in the central part in the CPU you have a memory, which is the which can be the random access memory, where data is when your computer is on, data is stored till the computer is on. When your computer is put off, the data is lost from the RAM, and the ROM, where it is more permanent. The RAM is for just immediate access, so higher the RAM space, the faster the computer works, processing speed of the computer, because the it stores it over there. So input is any data or instruction that is entered into the memory of a computer. Any hardware component allows user to enter data and instructions into a computer. Keyboard and mouse are the most commonly used input devices. Then this is the structure of a keyboard. It is used to enter information into the computer, and it is used for giving commands. A standard computer keyboard is called a QWERTY keyboard. If you look at the keyboard in India, you have we use the US pattern of keyboard system. In UK and Germany, in Germany I use the German system of keyboard. When I was in UK, I bought a laptop that had got the German system of keyboard. It had German symbols. So basics were same, but there are few keys which are different. So in India we use the US pattern of United States pattern of keyboard. The keyboard which you see in front of you, it is the US pattern. One of the main differences is that on the top of the two button you find the at the rate symbol, whereas in the UK and the German keyboard, on top of the two you will find an the quotation mark there, the double quotation mark present. So there are certain differences, there are certain extra characters. Now we are thinking about introducing a rupee symbol, which has been introduced in our Indian computer. If you see this is my keyboard over there, you see a rupee symbol being inserted over here in this keyboard. A rupee symbol has come. This is basically it follows the US pattern, but the special Indian symbol has got this rupee symbol which has been put up. So we have also, India has also started its own computer keyboard layout, where in this region where you are supposed to have let's increase the size over here. You are supposed to have this almost approximate sign and this particular keyboard in this region. Suddenly you find that you put in another rupee symbol. So basically it's a US pattern, only once extra symbol has been put, that is the rupee symbol. So then we go to the next part. You have the ball mouse. In former times when I started, there used to be a ball inside. That ball, when you move the, used to move the mouse, the ball also used to move. But lot of dust used to accumulate, so that had got replaced by the optical mouse. This is the optical mouse which you see. A light is there below. Then you have the output unit. The job of the output unit is just the reverse of that of the input unit. It supplies information and results of computation to the outside world. So your monitor and printer are the most commonly used output devices. So this is the monitor. It is a display screen. It is used to provide the output to the users. It is where you can view the information you are working on. This is what you are seeing actually. Then you have the printer. It is an output device that produces a hard copy of the information in the printed form. Then you have the memory storage devices. All computers need to store data. Data is stored temporarily while program is running. That is the main memory. That is your RAM, basically. That is the main memory, the RAM. Random access memory. It is stored temporarily while the program is running. And to store data for long term usage, to preserve it, you have the main memory, the hard drive, the ROM. So you have a primary, and this is actually store the data. So the RAM, when you put the computer on, it takes data from your hard drive. Nowadays you have two types of hard drive, the former HDD drives where you had an optical disk moving like a CD, little CD moving inside in this hard drive, and now this is supported by the pen drive type of solid state drive, SDD, SSDs. The SSDs are much more faster. It's got a pen drive LED based system. The SSDs are faster. They give data to the RAM much more faster, the SSDs. In the HDDs, the RAM has to access your data from your hard drive. It used to circle, but here suddenly the LED light automatically comes. So you can increase the speed of your computer by using SSDs and increasing the RAM of your computer. So the primary memory, it is the temporary area for holding data, to store program currently being executed, to hold data while the, so primary memories are of two types, like I told, RAM and your ROM. That is your primary, the inside you have a RAM, below that is the ROM, where the system data is put inside the ROM. Then the RAM is the random access memory. It is the major portion of the primary memory. Memory that is used by the program in execution. If the computer gets off, RAM will use all the data. So you have a static RAM and a dynamic RAM. The RAM, different types of RAM, we don't need to go into details about so much. But you understand that there are two types of RAM. One is a static RAM and one is a dynamic RAM. So the RAM basically, when your computer is working, or different processes which are going, the RAM is providing memory space for the different processes which are going. the RAM is providing the space. But when you shut the computer off, the RAM gets all what, say you have opened a Word file, you have opened a PDF file, you have opened the WhatsApp file, you have opened so many windows together. So the RAM is storing all this information. So whenever you are going from one window to the another, it's all present in the RAM. So where you have, if you have a low RAM capacity, the number of windows and processes open, your computer will keep on working very slowly. Or for a slower computer which has got low RAM, you have to reduce the number of windows you are working with. So this is how RAM. So when you put the computer on, you see it takes some time. That is the time needed for RAM to take certain processes from your main memory, from your hard drive memory, or the read-only memory, random ROMs. Then a static RAM is the memory is retained as long as the power remains applied. It is more faster. Nowadays we all use static RAM. The dynamic RAM, it needs to continue refreshing in order to maintain data. We don't need to study too much about these. We don't need to study too much about all these things. So ROM is read-only memory, memory which we can only read but which cannot write on. It is non-volatile. The memory in the RAM was volatile. That is, the moment you put it off, poof, it's all gone. But ROM, which is below the RAM, inside the main memory chip, under the RAM you have the ROM which is present. This ROM has got the system data. It is non-volatile. It is saved. But we can only read it. It cannot be erased. If you erase the, if a problem happens, then you have to completely change everything in the computer. It is used to store some firmware program like DOS. It uses a lot of ROM space. When you boot the computer on, you see that the functions which work, the screen display which come, this coming from ROM. Then you have PROM, EPROM, all these different things, but you don't need much information on these, but just the name. PROM means programming, programmable read-only memories. EPROM means erasable and programmable read-only memories. EEPROM is electrically erasable and programmable read-only memories. Then the secondary memory is your hard drive and optical disk, external hard drives, pen drives, CD drives, CD, these are all the secondary memories. It's just to store the information. Magnetic disk. We used to use MO, these magnetic disk in former times. It used to look like a floppy disk. Floppy disk, when I started, I used to use this big floppy disk in school when I started to learn computers, this 5.5 inches. It used to store only hardly 512 KB of data. Then we had the smaller floppy disk. It used to store 1.44. I still have two of them in my house. So 1.44 MB of data, that is nothing. So those have become obsolete, floppy drives. Then you had this MO, which had used to store something like 252. It had something like a CD drive, an optical drive moving in between. Like your hard drive, but it is a primitive version. MO. Those were not very stable. So on magnetic imprints, these binary codes are imprinted in these magnetic disks. Dots and dashes, those are interpreted as what you are seeing right now in a binary configuration. So it's stored in these magnetic disks. Then you have, these are the hard drive. So if you just open a hard drive, you see the CD like structure. This keeps on rotating. So this is the HDD versions, the older versions. Nowadays you have the SSD, the solid state drives, where you have a circuit instead of these. This drive keeps on circulating like a gramophone record. So whenever you are needing, maybe your data is located somewhere in a small sector over here, your little file is located over here, then you are asking for that file. So this starts to move, and this gramophone like pin, it's like starts to search for that file. When it comes to that file, it takes that file and brings it and displays it in the output to you. So this is where this particular how it is stored. Therefore, it takes time, much more time. It the hard drive tape, but that is very time means it's working fine, right now my computer is using a solid state drive. Problem with solid state drive is it is expensive and you don't get much memory of that. For me it is 256 GB where that costed around of 3500 rupees. When 3500 rupees I can get a 1 TB HDD drive. But the speed means I can work with 8 windows. I'm recording, I'm at the same time using OBS, at the same time I'm using a PowerPoint, and my internet connection is working, PDF is open, a Word file is open, 10 internet windows are open. Still you can you are having no function, you are having no problem, and Google Drive is also running. That is because I've got an 8 GB RAM and an SSD working around with it. If it was an HDD, then perhaps this would have hanged. It used to happen before when I used to take my class in my small laptop. That was at that time it used to hang and it used to crash and all these things used to happen. Then you have the floppy drives. Plastic coated disks. So these are primitive and backdated. Just to know the name, you don't need to study much of, you'll never be using it. You have the optical drives, you have the CDs, where the laser it reads on your CD where your file is located. Then you have the processor or the central processing CPU. The CU, control unit, and the arithmetic logical unit together are jointly known as the CPU. We will, and it's also the microprocessor. We will discuss right now on more on this microprocessor. It performs data processing and operations. It controls the workings of the entire system. So it consists of the arithmetic and logic unit and the control unit. We have to study about these microprocessors. So the arithmetic and logic unit, it is the place inside the CPU where actual execution of the instructions takes place. The actual brain of the computer, where 1 plus 1 is equal to 2 is done. The arithmetic and the logic, where x is greater than y, this function is done over there in the arithmetic and logical unit portion. And all the calculations, as you know, there are a lot of calculation processes present. they are present. You have arithmetic operators, plus, minus, division, multiplication. You have also logical operators like greater than, lesser than, and, or. You have even logical operators. You have Boolean operators like and, or, logical operators like greater than, equal to, lesser than, equal to, and you have Boolean operators, and, or, not. You have different types of computer logical operators are present, which you can, are used. So all these functions are done in this ALU, or arithmetic and logical unit. It consists of circuits that perform arithmetic as well as logical operations. And you have the control unit. If you, I cannot open and show you my hard drive right now, otherwise the class will stop. You can find that the control unit is located beautifully in this region. You have the RAM and the ROM and the arithmetic logic unit are located in the center in the microprocessor unit. It is the central nervous system for the computer. It manages and coordinates like the brain and spinal cord. It manages and coordinates the entire computer system. It gets information from the main memory. So it's integrated to this motherboard in this particular region. And you have other circuits over the other circuits, small circuits, NPN junction semiconductors, which perform other functions. Yeah, but the main part is over here. Then you have other connections to this, which is attached to, for example, the cooling fan. You have attached to the SMPS and all other monitor. You have all several connections. These are all plug points to attach our different units over there. So now I will go to the next part, which is माइक्रोप्रोसेसर पार्ट. सो अ माइक्रोप्रोसेसर, दिस इज ऑन द मदरबोर्ड यू विल फाइंड दीज थिंग्स अटैच द माइक्रोप्रोसेसर. यू हैव इंटेल कोर 2, इंटेल डुअल कोर. फॉर मी इट इज i3. आई एम यूजिंग एन i5 प्रोसेसर, माइक्रोप्रोसेसर इन माई मदरबोर्ड. Formerly I used to use an i3, and before that my wife's computer, it's a Pentium dual core processor. So all these things I used, even Pentium 1, up to Pentium 1 also I had used Celeron processors also. We had different types of processor. What is a processor? Processor, it is a multi-purpose programmable logic device that reads binary information instruction from a storage device memory and accepts binary data as input and processes the instruction for execution. So you're typing something in your keyboard, it is converted into a binary code, a permutation and combination of 0 and 1. So that data is it reads that binary information, and that is saying something like I'm typing print, print. So that it is converted into binary information. So this processor, it is reading, it converts that into binary information from the input device. It is converting. Okay, so this guy wants to output as a print. So what it does, it processes and it sends to the output device, do print. So the logical function of converting that binary print command into a print display, that is done by this microprocessor. This is done in doing this logical part. So this was the Intel first generation 4004 microprocessor. You can see so many pins are used to be attached over there. This is a picture of this old microprocessor. You can find these on the motherboard. So these are different types of, later it's becoming smaller and smaller. All these microprocessors, different types of microprocessors. So a microprocessor has got an arithmetic logical unit. It has got a register, where register is where first the binary information goes, and it goes inside, then the logical operation is produced over here. The control unit is controlling what's happening, where input is coming, when the input is going to come, when the input is going to go and become an output, the control unit is going to do that function. So let us not go into much into the physics of it, how the NPN junction, although it's a very fascinating subject, the NPN junction semiconductor, how the binary digit is converted. Let us stick to our, as a biologist, let us stick to biology. And you have the register and arithmetic logical unit. So you have the microprocessor system, has a base system, it has got a memory, a system bus. A bus is something, the whole thing is a system. The microprocessor is a system. A bus is something which communicates information from one place to another place. That is a bus. With a bus, you go from one place to another place. Therefore, system buses, it communicates information from one place to another place. So, the memory, from the memory or from the input, information from the input comes through the system bus to the memory. From there, it goes into the register. From the register, it goes into the arithmetic logical unit, the control unit. It controls this particular process of input and output. And the control unit gives the information through the system bus route. It different wires, it goes, sends it to your output finally. So input from the memory, the information comes, goes to the register, and your input, it goes, register registers it. Okay, so tomar kotha ta ke register kora holo, then arithmetic logical unit does the logical function. Control unit says, okay, now information come in. When it goes to the register, control unit is basically controlling the function of both of these, and the control unit is also controlling, okay, now information go to the output, processed information now go to the output. So this is how the microprocessor essentially works. So memory is one of the most important factor in the microprocessor. It is used to store the data or information in a binary format. So microprocessor memory, you have a cache memory, temporary memory. A cache memory is used by the central processing unit of a computer to reduce the average time to access memory. So what happens in the cache memory, already that information is present. The window is already is present. The Word file which you have opened is already present in the cache, and it is stored. So when you are using it immediately from the cache, it's directly it's going. It's not going from the memory to the system bus to this. Already it is present inside. Money, I have got money, cash stored in my pocket, and I am not going to the bank. From the bank, I'll take take the cash, and then I will give the cash to you. No, I already have some cash stored in my pocket, but I can only store a limited amount of money in my cash. I cannot store my whole bank balance in my pocket. So you have to this cash. Once I remove the cash, my pocket is empty. So the cache is a smaller, faster memory which stores copies of the data from the most frequently used memory locations. Then what is the this is the bus. Bus is a communication system that transfers data between components inside a computer or between computers. So this is also a sort of wires from this system to this system. The communication is going. That is a bus. So let us look at a system bus model. How the system bus model looks like. You basically have three types of main types of bus. The first is the data bus, the second is the address bus, and the third is the control bus. So let us look at the data bus. Data bus information is transferred between the input-output unit, and it goes via the data bus to the memory input-output, and the data bus it also goes to the CPU. The data bus sends data from input-output unit to this. Then you have the address bus. The address bus takes the information from this region to the memory, and the memory takes the address bus from the CPU. The memory it is processes and it sends the memory to the address bus. So input output both ways, input inside, output from the address bus to the output, and it sends the data information to the memory, and the CPU what it processes the memory and sends information back to the address bus. And then you have the control bus, which controls the whole process, input output from both the CPU as well as input output from the memory, as well as input output from the input output units as well. So power bus is different as power switch. That is we need not study. It's an optional. We did not study about those things. So this is how the microprocessor works. So this is a 8-bit microprocessor. 8 bits make 1 byte. Remember, 1024 bytes make 1 kilobyte. 1024 kilobytes make 1 megabyte, MB, and 1024 MBs make 1 gigabyte. 1024 gigabytes make 1 terabyte, TB. So starts from 8 bits. So if you look at the figure 8, this part is 1 byte, this part may be 1 byte, 1 byte. So you have that is 1 byte over there. So 8 bits make 1 byte. So these are other microprocessor kits, pictures of these microprocessor kits. So Intel 8085, you can read about this. It's an 8-bit processor. It has multiplex address and data bus, AD0 and AD7. It works on 5 volt DC power supply. It provides 72 instructions with 5 different addressing modules. As these processors develop, this keeps on increasing. Nowadays we are using 64-bit processors. So this is how maybe you just practice this diagram. This is a Intel Core i7 processor. So we don't study about network. So this is how network we study on the next day. Up to processor, we finish the class over here. So with this, I am stopping my class, stopping the sharing. Do you people have got any questions? Kono proshno thakle jiggesh korte paro. Question আছে?
না স্যার।
ওকে তাহলে এই আমি আই হ্যাভ আপলোডেড দেম অন ইয়োর গুগল ড্রাইভ এই গুগল ক্লাসরুম ইউ উইল ফাইন্ড অন দ্য প্রসেসর আই হ্যাভ দিস আ হিউজ ফাইল বাট আই উড সে দ্যার আর টু পিপিটি ফাইলস ইউ রিড দ্যাট পিপিটি ফাইলস ফর ইয়ার এক্সাম দ্যাট শুড বি সাফিসিয়েন্ট
আচ্ছা স্যার
বাট ইফ ইউ ওয়ান্ট টু নো মোর দোজ টু ফাইলস আর দেয়ার সাডেনলি দোজ আর দ্য ইনফরমেশন উইচ ইজ প্রেজেন্ট ওভার দেয়ার Okay then, I am ending my class over here.